We continue our series. It's what is it? Number 6 or 7 today?
You did a double.
6, yeah. I did a double one. That's what confused. Yeah. So number 6 today, and hopefully I'll be able to finish it today. If not, we're gonna have one more time next Wednesday, and we'll finish it. We are. It's called Laws of Repentance, Ilchot Tshuva. Based on the words of the Rambam, which is, as I said in the first lecture, it's all come mainly from Masechet Sanhedrin, mostly from Masechet Sanhedrin. It's a wonderful piece of information, because besides learning how to do tshuva, repentance, is also spoke about the free choice, these famous questions that everybody asks. And now we're going to speak about something that is just as important. Is what is the next life? What's going to be when we die one day? And this is chapter 8.
In Masechet Sanhedrin?
Well, we're speaking from the Rambam, so remain, if you want to look for the source, it's Ilchot Tshuva. It's in the first book, there's Aleph to Vav, right? Mm-hmm. So it's in Chelek Aleph. And is in Ilchot Tshuva, Laws of Tshuva, Chapter 8, which is right somewhere in the middle of the book, okay? Atova tzfuna l'tzadikim hi lechaye ha'olam haba. The reward that is waiting for the righteous people is for the afterlife, for the next world. This is life that has no more death in it. Here, we all live, we live certain years. And in the end we died and it's over. So life over here, when a person died, they call him niftar. Or alach le'olamo. What does it mean? In Judaism you don't say he umet. On the wicked people, you can say he died, umet. Met is dead. But the people who are righteous, you don't say on them met, you say niftar. Niftar means like quit. Like passed on to a different place. That's what it means. And the second thing is, when they say Allah le'olamo, went to his own world, which means every person has his own world according to his level. No two individuals can get exactly the same reward, obviously. Because one mitzvah that you made more than your friend already changed your status completely. I saw in one of the books, they brought a story. Can you close that window? Thank you. In one of the books, I saw that they brought a story about two wives of two great rabbis. Who are they? The Gaon Mivilna. Yeah, if the noise of the cars, that's the problem. So, the wife of the Gaon Mivilna and the wife of the Magid Miduvna, they were all both in the same generation, they were good friends. And they used to go every day to collect tzedakah for different causes, for the yeshiva, for the poor people, for the widows, for the orphans, all kinds. And everything they ever did together, everything. And they made an agreement that whoever is going to die first, if they have permission to come in a dream to the one who's still alive, to tell them how is it up there, if they can do it. So the wife of the Magid Miduvna passed away first. And then she came to the wife of the Gaon Mivilna in a dream. And she told her, wow, you have no idea in what a great place I am. And I'm so happy in this. So she said to her, wow, I'm so happy. Because she knew that everything they did together. So if she's in a good place, I probably go to a good place as well. So she told her, no, you are in a much greater level than me. Whatever I have, you have a much greater level than me. So she told her, why? Everything we did the same. So she told her, no. When we went to collect, you were the one who always reached your arm to receive the tzedakah. I was just standing next to you. Sometimes I talk, sometimes you talk. But the one who put his hand forward was you. So you had a little bit more embarrassment than me all the time. Because you're the one who had to get the money. I was just standing. So your reward is much, much greater than me. There's nothing to compare. Why? Because the mitzvah that you did and you got embarrassed for it already is a much higher reward. So she told her, you are in a different league. This is just to give us an example of one little difference. After all, they both went to collect. They both walked. They both in the rain, in the sun, everything. You know? Shh, Moshe. Noises. Okay, so this is just to give us an example. Then, this is life that have no death with them, and good that doesn't have any bad mix in it. People ask, why there is so much bad in this world? So much tragedies, problems, the sicknesses, divorce, bankruptcies, problems with the families, with the children. Ooh, if you have to write the list, it starts from here and it ends next year. Or if you have to write all the problems. And it's just not ending. So the question is, why there's so much bad in the world? There's also a lot of good, Baruch Hashem. But why? The answer is, if there was no bad in the world, you would never enjoy the good. You're only able to enjoy from the good when the good comes in between bads. Bad, 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 boom, something good comes. If from the minute you're born, everything was good, they will take it for granted. You'll never appreciate it. What is it like? A kid that was born to a rich father. All his life, the best toys, 16, he already have an expensive car, always had unlimited money. So he grew up with a situation that he thinks that that's the way life is, right? Take this boy and take him 1 month away from his home, put him in jail. 1 month. And then bring him back to his family. From now on, the pleasure he's going to have from his father's money is going to be a lot greater. Why? Now he appreciates what he has. Up to now, it was a way of life. Well, everyone has it in his eyes. It's nothing special. That's the way it should be. It should be much better. When you take it away from him, now he begins to appreciate what he never appreciated until now. Same thing here. If a person was always healthy, always, no one's getting sick, nobody would appreciate his health and the miracles that Hashem does for him. If a person, everything in the life of a person, everything work out perfect, everything perfect, life would not have any excitement. It's boring. You wouldn't enjoy it. You only enjoy now when you know it could have been a lot worse and Hashem made you a bigness and you got away with something. Wow, such happiness. When everything is like this, you think this is the way life is. Same thing, oxygen. Do we appreciate that we have oxygen 70 years non-stop? No, you know why? Never heard of a shortage with oxygen. Everyone has it. Imagine if you hear that in some places in the world, the oxygen stop and 1 million people fall and die. And every month somewhere else. Every day you have oxygen, you begin to praise Hashem for 2 hours in the morning just for something that you have already 40 years and you never thought to say thank you. Why you begin to say thank you? Because you begin to hear on the news, same thing, earthquake. Did we ever say thank you to Hashem that we lived in Israel or we live here in New York all these years and there was not even one incident? No. Now when we see what happened to the Goyim, right? New Zealand, right after that Japan, who knows who's next? You begin to think, wow, we are so lucky. It could have happened to us. Mm-hmm. Now we are not Japan. If something 1% of what happened to them would happen in Israel, Israel is bankrupt forever. That's it. Israel can lose $400 billion. This is what the damage already. $400 billion before they even started to analyze what happened. It's going to get to trillions of dollars. If you take $1 trillion, you buy half of Israel. The damage they have in this earthquake, the country is over. It can rebuild the whole country. What is Israel? The size of Tokyo? So, you know, the miracles that we have, and don't forget, in history, there was earthquakes in Israel. In Tzfat, he wiped up the whole city. There was incident. It's not that it never happened. But it happened in a generation that there was no big buildings, no bridges, none of the things we have today, no electric, no, none of the things. Earthquake. So a little house, tiny wood house, fell on the floor. So you come, you rebuild it. 1 week of your life is gone. There's no bridges like today, buildings like in Tel Aviv. One little incident now could be 1 million people die. Gas leaks, all these things did not exist in this earthquake that happened in Tzfat. There was very primitive life. Few horses fell, few donkeys fell, few houses cracked, finished. That's what happened. People died because the houses fell on their head. But compared to today, if the same earthquake that happened in Tzfat, I think it was 8 years ago or more, I don't remember the day. I don't know, a long time ago. It was in a generation there was nothing now, like now. If it would happen now, there's no way to count how many bodies Chas v'Shalom would have. You understand? Now, so the Rambam say, this is good that there's no bed in it. Shenemar, the Torah says, Leman yetav lecha ve'arachta yamim, that you should benefit, I should benefit you, and you have a long life. Ve'arachta yamim. Now, what's considered aroch in the eyes of God? 7 years is long? It's a joke. 1 million years is long? It's also a joke. 1 billion years is long? It's also a joke. Whatever you're going to say is going to be a joke. You say 100 billion years. It's a joke. Why? Compared to Hashem, is nothing. It's eternity. When Hashem say long, it's the longest you can think of, which is endless. You understand? Because if Hashem say long, we can say, oh, long, 7 years, 700 years, 7,000 years, 7 million years. No matter what you're going to say, it's a joke. That's long compared to what Hashem can give? That's not long. The Torah continue to say like this. Leman yetav lecha ve'arachta yamim, that you should have good life and you should live long life. And we learn mipi ha'shmua, it went from generation to generation all the way from Moshe Rabbeinu to today. Leman yetav lecha le'olam shekulo tov, that you should receive your reward in a world that it's all good. Nothing is bad over there. Ve'arachta yamim le'olam shekulo aroch, and you go to a world that is never going to end. Eternity. This is the time maybe for me to add what the Gemara says in Pirkei Avot, that if you take all the physical pleasure of all the people, of all the generations combined, it will not be equal to 1 hour of the pleasure of the righteous Jews in Olam Haba. Take billions of people who live here, take all the good they ever had, food, vacation, pretty wives, delicious food, whatever you can think of, children, sport, money, I don't know, art, you name it. No, I think I covered everything that people like. Of all the people combined, of 5,771 years, all combined, there will not be equal of the reward of 1 hour of every one of the religious, righteous Jews from the time they died. So it pays to sweat. It pays to sweat. So, לעולם שכולו ארוך וארכת ימים, לעולם שכולו ארוך. And this is the next life. ברוך אתה, אמן, לעולם שהכל יהיה לדבר.
אמן.
לא צריך. שכר הצדיקים, the reward of the righteous people, that there will be life, peaceful life. You know what it means? נועם, דרכי הדרכי נועם. נועם, it's pleasant. Life today is far away from being pleasant. No person in the world, not even the sheikhs, the billionaires, the presidents, the kings, whatever you want, none of them have pleasant life. If you put a camera attached to Obama from the minute he wake up and see what he's going through every day in office, I promise you, there's nothing to be jealous with. You look at the Prime Minister of Israel, or now the Prime Minister of Japan, they would rather be dead than handle the situations they have every day. The only reason people want to be leaders is the ego. They want to be memorized in history. It's fame, glory, ego, money. Many of them sacrificed a lot of money to become president. Sometimes the amount of money they put in their election and the advertisement, they could live 700 years in this world without working. With the amount of millions that they wasted on advertisement and television and commercial, they could have taken the money and put it in their pocket. Prime Minister of Italy is a multi-billionaire. Every election he spends $100 million from his pocket. He doesn't need donation. From his own pocket, he's the owner of Fiat company. He's a very rich person, owner of soccer teams. Yeah, he owns tons of businesses. He wastes fortune to be a president. He would be much better off to be a businessman. He doesn't need to be a president for the money. But he wants the fame. An important person. But really, their life is not pleasant. It's a lot of pressure. People speak against them. They criticize them in a newspaper. Rich people, almost every one of them is sick. Ulcer, heart attacks, cancer, handicap, problems with the wife, problem with the kids, extra weight, cholesterol, this, that, so many problems. Life is not perfect here. Nobody has perfect life. And even if a person is lucky not to be sick, or, you know, and his business is relatively smooth, he cannot come and say that his life is full of pleasant, because there are fear, economy, the rich people always worry, the bank will collapse, I lose the money, my partner who's cheating me, who's stealing me, my employees, they'll call me to the army next month, it's going to be an earthquake, where am I going to hide my money? I know a woman who works for one of the richest Jewish family in the world. She takes care of her kids, and she told me 2 weeks ago, I gave her a ride, and she told me on the way that her boss, when she gave a donation to Yeshiva University, $100 million in one check, and a month or two later he gave another donation, $40 million, to a school in Westchester. And he gave tens of millions of dollars to a hospital in Manhattan. Just imagine how much he has if he gives so many tens of millions in donations. He told her that he was worried about the future. Where should he hide money? Why? He see that it's going to be a revolution here in America, because all the middle class becoming poor, and soon you're going to have a lot of wild beasts that are not, they're starving, they cannot get food, and the government is going to be bankrupt, so it's not going to be food stamps anymore, no Section 8, none of these things. So it's going to be about 70 million Americans homeless in one shot. They're not going to have anything, so they're going to start going with machine guns and with fire and burn stores and make riots, and all the rich people here would be afraid to show their face. They're going to have to escape the country. It's not only in the Arab countries that it happens. It can happen here. The people here are just as fanatic as like the Arabs. Why? When a person is poor, he doesn't care what's going to happen. There's nothing to lose. That's why in Mexico, all the rich Jews have bodyguards with machine guns. All their cars is bulletproof. Their kids cannot go to school without one or two bodyguards standing in the front of the class all day. They don't leave their eye from the kid. He wants to go to learn in school. He has one or two bodyguards. Why? Because over there, every moment, you're subject to a kidnapped. They kidnap people. An average American, an average Mexican, make $1,000 a year, $2,000 a year. An average multi-millionaire Syrian Jew who lives in Mexico make $1 million a week. They make $1,000 a year. So one Jew, with the amount of money he makes in international business, he makes like $500,000 Mexican makes, one person. The differences between the rich people that have private jets and big yachts in Mexico, they live in expensive mansions, to the rest of the Mexican, it's hard to imagine such a thing. How can it be that there's thousands of people work like crazy, like dogs, and they don't make all of them combined when one businessman in Mexico makes, Jew or non-Jew, it doesn't matter. So it's like two different worlds. And they all live with fear, because they know as soon as I'm going to walk one step on the street without my bodyguards, for sure they kidnap me. Many of the kidnapping ended up with $3 million ransom. To get your kid back, you had to pay fortune. So this is what's happening in certain countries, in Africa, in Mexico, in places like this. Also, you have to understand one thing. Here, the government always made sure that the poor people will get help to prevent such problems. But when the government go bankrupt and they cannot pay what they owe China, even the interest, the government will not be able to continue give 70 million American food stamps every week. They just won't be able to. Right now, they print money like crazy. But soon, the dollar won't have a value. So they're not going to be able to do it. And that's what's going to happen here. People who need money or food, they'll have. But other people will have a horrible time. So even the rich people here, they worry what's going to happen. They buy silver, they buy gold, they hide it. They hide it in safe. They hide it. He wants to go to some forest and dig a big hole and hide a box full of gold and silver for time of problems, time of emergency. You understand what's going on? He wants to go buy himself houses in different countries. Then in case this country also go down, I'll be able to run to this country. Or to the, you understand? So even these people don't have pleasant. No. They always worry. They worry in a business, my colleague, my competition. The pleasure of the next life is pure. Never ever a person after he dies and goes to heaven ever has to worry about anything. The meaning to be worried doesn't exist over there. Nobody loses hair, nobody becomes gray hair, cholesterol, high blood pressure, panic attack, anxiety attack, all kinds of things, bad dreams. None of this exists over there. The life is so pleasant and so pure that it's so worth it to be righteous just to get to these days. And it's eternity, there forever and ever. How much a person is willing to give for 1 hour of pleasure? 1 hour of physical pleasure, people are killing for it. Killing! Taking a life risk, risking their entire life just to enjoy half an hour. You see all the time what's going on here. So, Olam shekulo aroch, and the reward of the righteous people is they're going to have this pleasure and all the greatness of Hashem. And the wicked people who didn't listen to Hashem, the Reshaim, their punishment will be that they will not enter that world. The gate will be closed for them. No permission to enter. Ikartu veyamutu. Their soul will get cut out of this reward, and they would die eternal death, not temporary death. Over here, you were supposed to live 8 years old. You died 70, no, so you lost 10 years, big deal. Or you lost 20 years. Well, it's, anyway, it's all temporary, big deal. It's over anyway. But over there, the loss is a permanent loss. V'chol mi she'eno zoche lechaim elu hu amet. She'eno chai le'olam ela nichrat berisho ve'avat kabe'ema. That's it. Once he's lost like an animal. No continuation. And this is the karet that the Torah is speaking about. In 36 different scenes, the Torah says, V'nichreta ha'nefesh ha'im Yisrael. I cut that soul out of this life, out of the next world. Cut it. And he has no share to the world to come, God forbid. The karet is also ba'olam hazeh. There's two kinds of karet. It comes in duplication. One, that a person die younger. But that's not the substantial karet. The real karet is that after he die, he cannot enter his place where he's supposed to go. He lost it. Why? For his sins. That nefesh, that soul that comes out of the body in this world, will not enter the life of the next world. It gets cut permanently. The next world has no bodies, no material, no physical images, only spiritual things. The souls of the righteous people alone. Just like the angels, Malachi Asharet, that also don't have material in them, they're all spiritual. That's how life is over there. Since there is no images there, no material, there's also no eating and no drinking, and none of the things that the body needs. Right? Over there, you don't need air condition. You're not going to sweat because there's no body. No hot and cold, none of these things for the Olam Haba. To sweat, or to freeze, or to be sick, none of this exists over there. And the things that people need constantly in this world, they don't need over there. And all the tragedies that can happen to a body does not belong there. Like also ordinary things, like standing, sitting, sleeping, sadness, depression, etc., etc. None of it exists over there. That's what the Gemara say. The next world has no eating and no drinking, no relationship between man and a woman. You don't need it. It's all physical. The righteous people sit with crowns to their head and enjoy the greatness of God. In case you were thinking to ask me, what does it mean, define sitting with a crown to their head and enjoy the greatness of God? My answer is, I don't know how to describe it, because nobody in this world can even understand in imagination how great it's going to be. What is it like? Trying to explain a blind person how beautiful the color blue is. He never saw blue in his life. How many years is going to take you to describe blue? Did you close the window?
Mm-hmm. In the closet
one? No, the upper one also. Oh, yeah, I see it. There's noise. Yeah, so...
That's good.
Yeah, Baruch Hashem. So, the trying to explain to a blind person what blue looks like, There's no way. Why? Because he doesn't understand. He has no way to understand that. Because in his computer, he never saw colors. There's no way to describe it.
I have never died and gone up there and come back. But I'm just saying, we were all united. Like at the Kotel, I was there during the Tekes of the Kohanim. I mean, you feel the Shekhinah and you feel such a joy. And it's like... something you can't really describe.
No, but you have to understand. There are moments of joy in this world, of course. Among them, one of the things that you describe. But this joy, it's a joke compared to the real joy over there. Because you have to understand. Over here, even a person who sits and learns Torah and is addicted to the Torah. Uh-huh. And he enjoys it and he doesn't want to stop for a minute. And I know a few people like this. And you see that they're always smiling, like this, the Spirit of God is on their face nonstop. The pleasure that they have is not 1 billionth of the pleasure they're going to have over there. Why? Because over here we have obstacles. It's like in electric, you have resistance to the flowing of the electric. There's always resistance. The wider the wire is, there's more resistance. But over here, the same thing. The material that we have in us, it's the opposite of spiritual. And it ruins the pleasure. Why? The body is tired, the body is this, the concentration, you cannot focus, your back hurts, all kinds of things that takes away from the pleasure of the Torah. Plus, you are very limited. Why? Because Hashem wanted to show us that we are a combination of body and soul, and the physical actually overcoming the spirituality that we have. But over there, once the soul exits the body, the soul is 100% pure divine soul. No obstacle, no limitation, no problems in vision, in memory, in hearing, in remembering. Everything is going to be so perfect over there that over here, sometimes when you learn, you think, wow, I feel like I'm in a moon or something. But it's nothing, again, compared to the reward over there. So people ask me, what does it mean sitting with a crown and enjoying the greatness of God? The answer is, there's no way for us to understand. But one thing we can swear, that no matter how great you can imagine it, is 1 billion times better, at least. No matter how good you are, because when Hashem say, my greatness... that means there's nothing that comes even near this. Nothing. Whatever you're going to imagine. It's a joke compared to a real direct greatness from Hashem. Direct. Nothing else. There's nothing can even come near this. Ne'ni miziv ha'shchina. Ziv means like it's the honey who drips into a person's mouth. It's an analogy. Ne'ni miziv ha'shchina. Then, let's continue. The righteous people there have no physical efforts that they have to get tired, no concerns. Atarotem leroshem, these crowns to their head, talking spiritual crowns, that they have a full knowledge and full understanding why they are here, what brought them here, and for what mitzvot they're receiving this reward. And that's why it's great satisfaction. Wow, how lucky I am that I kept Shabbat. How lucky I put tefillin. How lucky I learned Torah. How lucky I didn't speak Lashon Hara. How lucky I helped, I did chesed. All these things. I didn't steal, I didn't do this. I ate only strictly kosher. I pray a lot with my heart to Hashem, and I always worked on my spirituality. Now when I see what I'm receiving for it, it's amazing. But at the same time, you should know also that I saw in one place that it says that when the righteous people see what they could have got, they see what they got. Great reward. But when they see what they should have got if they do a little more, it doesn't give them rest in the beginning to see, wow, another hour of learning Torah will already be in this place. Wow, what a loss. Over there it's clear. Everything is materializing into reality.
Okay.
Yeah.
Isn't it not fair that the body does all the work and doesn't get anything reward? Because your body's doing
no, work. The body doesn't do any work. All the work, the soul moves the body. Everything is the soul. All the pain you have, everything, it's all the soul. So without the soul, the body is dead on the floor. It cannot move.
Rabbi.
You know, so if I move the glass, you don't give reward for the glass, right? If I take the glass and spill it on a plant, give him water. Who the plant should reward? The cup or me? I'm the one who moved it, right? Moses. Yeah. So, it's eternal happiness on their head. And the happiness is not coming to goof, to a dead material, no. Only to the soul. כדי שתנוח על הראש, כך התרה שאמרו חכמים היא הידיעה. התרה means knowledge. First of all, you have to know one thing. The knowledge that a person reached over there, all the mysteries, all the myth in this world, all the question, all the misunderstanding, all the things that you try to understand and you couldn't reach that level, over there it's piece of cake, it's all so clear. It reminds me, there are people, you know, they run all their life with questions against Hashem. Every day they have a new question. Why, in that case, why this has happened? I don't believe. It cannot be. Why God is doing this? Why did this? Why does it have to be? Why this person deserves such death? What? Oh, they have a lot of questions. So Hashem sees that nobody can answer their question, so He takes them very fast near Him, that He can answer them all their questions. You understand? Yeah, it sounds like a joke, but it's true. Oh, you have so many questions? Okay, come to the next world. Over here, you understand everything.
Like
you don't want to have patience?
It sounds like you're trying to scare somebody so they don't ask a question.
No. You can ask questions, but you have to understand. First of all, every question has the answers. If you learn Torah, you see that 99.9% of your questions are gone right there. Most of the questions come as results of ignorance. Ignorance. I'm willing to make a test with you. You go home, write the hardest 100 questions you ever had in your life. And I am committing to you that I can show you the answer to each one of them in the books. So, who's right? Me. Why? Because I claim that if you have questions, it comes from ignorance. Ignorance is your fault, not me and not Hashem's fault. If you are an ignorant Jew, which means in Judaism, you can be a genius, you can be a doctor, you can be a lot of things. But when it comes to Judaism, if you are ignorant person, it's 100% your fault. As a result of your laziness or whatever reasons that you don't come to learn Torah, you have tons of questions. All these questions are born as a direct result of your sin. What is your sin? Not learning enough Torah, as the Torah commanded you. You understand? And I'm telling you from my own experience. Learn from my own experience. Every year, my questions that I have are less and less. But today, I can count on one hand how many unsolved mysteries I still have. Questions that I'm wondering why and how. Why, over the years, I found the answer to this, I found the answer to this, I found the answer to this. The more you know, the less mysteries you have. Very simple. You understand? Same thing in math. Same thing in anything. The more you know about accounting, If you're a beginner accountant, most likely your customer will suffer tremendous loss because you don't know all the tricks and all the laws of the IRS, especially when they keep changing it every 2-3 months. There's always provision, extra, last minute change, this year only bonus for education, how many kids you have, corporation, individual, married, filed separate. Ooh, there's a lot to know. Believe me, it's not simple to be an accountant. Just knowing the ordinary things, how to fill up a tax return, fine. It can be good to people who have not that much. They have a salary, they show, they have a little expenses, and it's over. But companies, complicated, they have overseas, they have here, they have in different states. You have to know a lot. The more you know, the more money your customers and you make. The less you know, you're creating damage to you and to the world. Same thing over here. If it's in accounting like this, it's needless to say, when it's the most important thing, the information of God, no? If you don't know that, what do you expect to be successful in life? So nobody scares anyone from asking the question. This is the way of the Christians. By Christians, you're not allowed to ask any question. Not allowed. If you ask in a church a question, they warn you. Second time, they will show you the way out. That reminds me about one elephant. One elephant wanted to do a mitzvah today and to pray in Minyan. So he come to the shul. He see that the Jews, they started to pray, you know? So the elephant is trying to walk through the door. But the door is very narrow. They can't come in. So the Jew is coming and asking him, what are you doing here? He said, I want to join you. I see beautiful prayer here. I want to join at least once in my life. Let me pray. They told him, no, what are you trying to make it into this shul? Don't you see the fancy church across the street? Over there you can go smooth. Look what a door they have. Look, over there you don't have to shove yourself in. So the elephant said to them, you're crazy? With this kind of nose, you want me to go over there? I belong here. I belong here. Well, it takes your time to understand, I think. That's what the Nazis used to think. My wife showed me a picture, what the Nazis think it's an ultimate, beautiful, perfect face. They were very racist. So they said, these, the Jews are like rats, ugly, big noses, this, that. And this is an Aryan thing. And in the end, this person that they showed was a Jew. You see that book? It's a famous picture. It was a perfect face. It was 100% a Jew, the father and the mother. Wow. Just to show them that all this Aryan racism is all nonsense. But anyway, let's move on. No, I do. They didn't know. And eventually they found out that he's a Jew after they made the flyers and movies and everything. So, okay, now anyway, so the knowledge is a great pleasure over there. Every little question you ever had, why I missed the plan, why this, why I didn't get married, why I got married, why I didn't have children, why I don't have children, why my son was like this and the other one was, everything over there, it's so clear. All the mysteries of all your reincarnations, everything is clear. Nothing. This is what the Zohar say, notnim lo la'adam reshut lirot dvarim that he couldn't see in his life. Person get permission to see things that he didn't have permission to see in his life. Over there he sees everything. Then it says like this. What does it mean enjoying the greatness of God? Reaching a level of understanding the real truth of God in the highest level possible. Which over here we don't even know 1% of the truth of Hashem. The Torah says, Mishpatei Hashem emet tzadeku yachdav. The Torah of Hashem and the laws of Hashem are emet, but you can only see it when they all combine together. If you see a part from the Torah, a part from here, a part from there, it's like looking at a puzzle with 10,000 pieces and only a few here, a few there, one here, one there. You don't see any picture. They ask you, what's this puzzle show? I don't see anything. I see a little yellow, I see a little green, I see brown. I see a little ocean, but I really don't know where it is. Can you tell me what city is this? No. But when you have the entire picture, it's all perfect.
That's over there, the puzzle becomes very clear. So many things that you have no understanding how it works, what does it mean, reincarnation, this, that, everything becomes real. And that's a great pleasure. Then, all the pleasure of the soul and this life that doesn't have any death with it, we call it, in the language of the Torah, Tzror HaChaim. Tzror, it's like you know, when the bees make honey, so it's all concentrated together. All the souls over there are concentrated together in life of eternity, and every soul who joined them, it's like a magnet. Another soul joined that unit, what we call life of eternity. And the reward over there is the highest that you can possibly imagine. And this is what all the prophets were talking about. This is what they were talking in all the prophecies, all the great analogies that the prophets gave. It's all for that time that the soul will arrive to that place. Then, for instance, they use certain analogies how to call that place. One place they call it the mountain of Hashem, Har Hashem. The mountain, Mi Ya'aleh Be'Har Hashem. What's the Mi Ya'aleh Be'Har Hashem? Who's going to go in the mountain of God? Which mountain? No. You think that they're talking about climbing on a mountain? It's an insult. What's to do on a mountain? To see the sheep over there? To see their bathroom, what they made over there. To see a few Arabs, Bedouin, taking care of the donkeys. What? Mi Ya'aleh Be'Har Hashem. It's all I explained. It's an analogy. This is all who's going to go into that great world of next world, which what we call heaven. Mekom Kocho. Mi Ya'aleh Be'Har Kocho. Mekom Kocho. The place of holiness. Chatzrot Hashem. The yard of God. Noam Hashem. The greatness of God, Oel Hashem, the tent of God, right? The Bet Hashem, the house of God, Shar Hashem, gate of God. All this is the names of what the prophets call that great place, what we call life in the afterlife. And the scholars, the Chachamim, they wanted to give names in a way of analogy, right? And they explained that there will be a seuda mezumenet la tzadikim, a great meal that all the righteous people are gathered together and eat. But of course, like I just explained, there's no body, no mouth, no teeth, no stomach, nothing. It's all an analogy, the mashal, derech mashal. The right, their prophets and the Torah spoke to us in a language that we can understand, that we can imagine an image. But if they speak to us in a language of that world, anyway, we won't understand anything. It's like speaking Chinese to us. It won't do any good. But if a Chinese person speaks to us Chinese, but demonstrate what he's talking about, show us a little bit something similar, chair, table, cup, a watch, we get an understanding what he's talking about. We don't understand 100% because we don't understand the language. But he gives us some kind of a picture for us to understand a little bit, to make us anxious enough to get there. You understand the idea here? It's like I'm coming to tell my son, I'm going to take you to Israel, to a great place. If I'll explain him about the place, he won't understand anything. So I tell him something he likes. There's a lot of cartoon over there. Ah, it's much better than cartoon. But what would he understand? Ah, cartoon he likes. Yeah, the bird by this, all this nonsense that kids like. You know, you talk to them in a language they understand, you give them enough incentive to earn it. When they get there, they see it's a billion times better than the nonsense that they thought they're going to get. And now they appreciate you. Oh, thank you for giving me this analogy that I get myself there. Then, their revenge against the wicked people, there is no greater revenge than that. That will be cut out of life of eternity and will not see this great place. Sheneemar, Hikaret, Hikaret HaNefesh. Hai, Avonaba, that soul will get cut.
because of the sins that it has. Avon, it's intentional sins. Chet is not intentional sins. Avon is intentional sins. Pesha, it's intentional sins on purpose to get God angry, which means you have glat kosher steak and not kosher steak, same cow. Glat kosher, slaughtering, perfect, from McDonald's, same one, but not kosher. What's the problem? Eat the glat kosher. The taste is exactly the same, one steak. No, I want this on purpose. Why? To get the rabbi angry, to get God angry. Dafka, I'll do a dafka. Why? My grandfather died in the Holocaust. That's my revenge. There are stupid people like this. That's how they talk.
Maybe it tastes better to them. It cannot be that it tastes better for them?
Could be. Still. No, the difference is very, very minor. Could be. You know why it tastes better? Because it's marinated in pee. Urine.
Oh my God.
Yes. Yeah. You know how when you eat non-kosher meat, you know what's in it? They kill the cow. They don't slaughter it. For hours, it's laying there until they get to it. It's thousands. They electrocuted them. They put them all on a metal floor. They put 500 volt. They're all electrocuted. They fall on the floor. And it takes them 2 or 3 days until they get to all of them, cut them open, take the skin off. They walk over there. In the meantime, there's buckets of urine and blood that is in the stomach of the cow. And because the cow is laying dead, it's like putting tons of meat in a big bowl of urine, and it's marinated, and it's absorbed inside the meat. And when later they cut it, it's very, very juicy. Their meat is more juicy than glat kosher. Why? When you slaughter the animal, first thing you do is put a lot of salt, and it takes all the liquid out, all the urine, all the blood, and then you wash it. So the meat that you eat is very clean. Less dirt, less urine, less bacteria, less all these poisons that they have. But it's not as tasty, because, you know, when you put the meat with the urine, it's softer, because it was in liquid for a long time, you understand? Some places, they put the meat in Coca-Cola for a few hours, because Coca-Cola destroys everything. You put a quarter inside a Coca-Cola, you come next month, there's no quarter in a glass. Yeah. It eats everything. Coca-Cola can clean ras, can clean... Amazing. I saw one time in email what they did with Coca-Cola. From here, you see what a poison it is to enter into your body. Take a tooth, put it 3 days in a glass with Coke, the tooth... Yes, 100%. And so they put the meat in Coca-Cola, it makes it very soft. Then they wash it very good, and they put it in all these fancy schmancy restaurants in Manhattan. They have ways. Why do you think they charge you $70 a steak and people run and stand online? Wow, Abba, it's such a thick steak. Pleasure, it tastes so great. So in a non-kosher place, you don't need Coca-Cola. It's in the urine of the cow. They cut it thick and it's very juicy. By the glad kosher, since they got rid of all the pee and all the dirt, they have to make it soft somehow. So they use other ways to do it soft, to make it soft. Okay, they bang on it with a hammer, they have all kinds of ways. Anyway, so this destruction that the prophets describe, they also gave analogies. Be'er shachat, a well with no bottom, that a person falls there and you never see him again. And a lost that can never be recovered. This is the right expression for it. It's a lost that it's too late. That's it. There's no way to correct. Once a person is there, he's there. That's it. You may think, Shema takel be'enecha tova zo, v'tedame she'en sachar ha-mitzvot, v'heyot ha-adam shalem bedarkei ha-emet, ela li'oto ochel v'shote. You may think, I don't believe. The real reward is what we have here. Delicious food, beautiful wife, great clothing, vacation, fancy house, all kinds of furniture makes from elephant teeth. What do you call it? Shenhav. How do you say in English?
Shenhav.
No, the teeth of the elephant. Shenhav in English?
Ivory.
Ivory. Ivory, I think. Ivory, yeah. Yeah.
just the Rambam continue to say here, it says like this. David HaMelech was anxious to already get to that place. לחיי העולם הבא, שנאמר, לולא האמנתי לראות בטוב השם בארץ חיים. I'm doing all these things. If I would not believe and know the reward in the land of life, life of eternity, I would not do anything. Which means I know that what I'm doing will get me to that place and I can wait already. כבר הודיעונו חכמים הראשונים, the great sages already informed us that the next world, a person cannot reach in this life the greatness and the level of the next world and the beauty of it. Only God knows 100% the level of the next world. Nobody can reach 100% the greatness of that place. And all the prophecies that the prophets gave, most of them are to the days of Mashiach. They spoke about days of Mashiach. What does it mean, days of Mashiach? That there's going to be the resurrection of the dead, and the souls will come back, resurrect inside the bodies for 1,000 years here. It's going to be great days here. Nobody has to walk, no more war, no more suffering, no more sicknesses. Those are the language of the prophets, but they spoke about the time that will come right after the arrival of the Mashiach, that a person will return to the level of Adam before the sin, that the body and the soul is holy. But that's nothing compared to the life of eternity that we are speaking here about. You understand what we're talking here about? This is a high level, yes, with the body, with no evil inclination, no yetzer hara, beautiful days. No war, no more Arabs torturing you, no more bombers, no more this, none of these things. Fine. But with all due respect to these great days, as the prophets describe them, right, there's still nothing compared to the final step, which is life of eternity, that the soul separate again from the body and go to that place as we spoke about for the last hour. Ain lo ra'ata Elokim zulatcha. Nobody saw God except God himself. Nobody. No, which means nobody can understand the greatness of God in this place. Not even the prophets. They understood a little bit, but not enough. And Hashem is preparing all this for the people who are wishing to get there, for the people who are anxious to get there, for the people who does everything they can to be able to enter there. For them he prepared it. The sages and the prophet says, describe all the days of Mashiach, aval ha'olam haba, but the next world, ayin lo ra'ata Elokim zulatcha. They couldn't say that much. Besides few analogies, righteous people sit with the crown, enjoy the greatness of God. Few, four, five sentences. That's all they had to say about the life of eternity. In all the prophecies. Because to describe it, even the prophets couldn't describe it. Days of Mashiach, it's over here. They describe it 100%. What's going to happen, the big war, what's 2/3 of the world dying, the other third, Hashem screened them, some of them will die, some of them will survive. No more war, the Gentiles that will survive will admire Israel. Everyone would learn Torah with no restriction, with no obstacle. Everything will be easy, no yetzer hara, nobody has to go to work. Plenty of food, plenty of money. Everyone is in peace because there's no evil inclination. No more gilgulim, no more birth. Because that's it. The souls are whatever corrected, corrected. Whatever is not is dead. There's no more giving birth. You understand? Therefore, this was not easy, but was possible to describe. That's what the prophets talked about. But the life of eternity, 4 or 5 sentences, that's all, in the entire Tanakh.
When Mashiach comes, are we going to have Haba and Gehenna?
When Mashiach comes, all the souls that are dead already, you have to understand, there are a few different places. There's a place called heaven. That's where the righteous people are right now. Then there is time of Mashiach here, the resurrection of the dead, which all the righteous people that are in heaven from the time
of the Torah until now, all the generations, the famous names that we read in the Tanakh, will all return into bodies to live here. And then there is a final step, final place, which called Olam Haba. So remember, Gan Eden, heaven, days of Mashiach here, and Olam Haba, which is the world of souls, the world of eternity. There's a few different names to it. World of eternity, world of the souls, or the next life. This is the final step. Over there, no more Kaddish, no more going up, no more going down. Final step. Right now, all the righteous people in heaven can continue to go higher and higher, depending what their children do for them. They do Kaddish for them, Tzedakah for them, they build yeshiva on their name, they do things with their money. The more they do with them and for them, or thanks to them, they can continue to elevate. Or every Rosh Hashanah, Kadosh Baruch Hu opened the file of every deceased righteous person and check what did you leave in the world. If things are good thanks to you, there are more mitzvot are done with the money you donated, people who you made religious made more mitzvot for you this year, every year you get an upgrade. But all these upgrades is only until the time of the resurrection of the dead. Once they're all going to be put in the body again, with no evil inclination, no more going up and down, that's it. And then when the world will be destroyed finally, there's no more material world, the souls go to the place where we call here and we've been describing for the last hour. So, we're almost done. I'm trying to think. Okay, so we have one more shiur we're going to do next Wednesday and we'll finish this whole series. Maybe now, since I have another 5-6 minutes, we can do some of chapter 9. We'll start it now. After we know that the reward of the mitzvot and the greatness that we're going to inherit, if we kept the word of God and the orders of the Torah, it's the afterlife. That's what we just said, life of eternity. Sheneemar leman yetav lach ve'erachta yamim, that you're keeping my mitzvot for your own reward, that you should go to long life, right? And the revenge that the wicked people will receive because they left and betrayed God, right, for all the sins that are described in the Torah. This is the karet, the cutting of the soul from that life of eternity. After we know all that, what is it that the Torah is saying? If you're going to listen, you're going to get it. And if you're not going to listen, this and this is going to happen to you. Such as hunger, war. If you're listening, it's going to be peace. And you get released from the Gentiles who try to depress you. And it's going to be rain, and it's going to be plenty of food. You're going to make a good living, etc., etc. How come, if the real reward is the life of eternity, why there's a large portion of the Torah who speaks about reward and punishment in this world? We also Auschwitz, no? So we see that people are subject to punishments in this life. We see so much divorce, cancer in every family, bankruptcies, problem with the children, all kinds of problems. There's no words to describe how many problems we have here, and also there is rewards here. Person make an easy living, he got a great wife, he's happy in his marriage, he has wonderful kids, this, that. This is all rewards here, right? He has rain, so we're not starving. So what is it, the Rambam asks? All of that is true. And it's a temporary situation. As long as we keep mitzvot, they all will come to us in this world. And when we violate those rules, we make sins, all these tragedies will come to us. But this is only the beginning of the reward, not the main reward, and also the beginning of the punishments, not the main punishment. If a person is sick, it's nothing compared to what he's going to get after he dies. The sickness here, it was to wake him up to make repentance. If he only took the pain and did not do nothing about it, he's going to receive another punishment after. This is only the beginning. Or reward. If a person gets some money, or gets a good house, or gets a nice car that he can go to yeshiva and learn, or, you know, all these things that we have, that's not really the reward.
It's just the beginning of the reward. It's like crumbs from the cake, not the real cake. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us Torah, which is a tree of eternity. And everyone who follows it knows 100% that everything comes for the afterlife. Yes, we get a little bit here, but don't ever think, God forbid, that the good that you got here, that's going to be your reward. That's why it's very foolish by many people that as soon as they become religious, they expect to be rich. Or if they pray today and Hashem didn't listen to them today, right away they have doubts. Or he gave tzedakah and they tow his car. I know a woman, she told me, I don't want to give tzedakah anymore. I'm afraid. I say, why? So every time I get stuck, something bad happened to me the next day. You understand how people think? Or a person pray, and right away he begins to think, hey, it's already a week that Hashem didn't listen to my prayer. You understand? This mistake comes because a person thinks that reward and punishment is only here. That's why I expect by keeping mitzvot to be successful in business. That's why 99% of the prayers of the Jews, unfortunately, is parnasa. Hashem, money, business, help me the deal, help me this, make sure my wife's father will pay for my house, this, that. It's all about money. Huh? Yeah. Shiduchim and money. But I'm talking those who are married. What are they praying for? Parnasa. Yeah, parnasa. I always say, if we would be connected to a lie detector that can read your mind. Which means, when you pray, it displays what you're thinking about. Not what you're saying. What you're saying, you're reading from the Siddur. What you are thinking about, after one time, we will hide for 70 years from the embarrassment.
What you're thinking about is the truth. What you're reading is what's written. What you're thinking about is the truth.
The truth, which is an illusion, fantasy.
Whatever, it's the truth.
Sometimes people mix between fantasy and illusion to a real truth. Praying for money all the time, it's a fantasy, it's not truth. Who said that it's good for you to be rich? Rav Moshe Malka, the big tzaddik, which was attached to the Baba Sali. That's one of the reasons why it's so tzaddik. You many years with such a tzaddik next to you. You better be a tzaddik, you know. So he said to me, not to me, in one of the breakfasts that we had together, he said in the whole table, he said that a person should never pray for something specific.
Really?
Yes, he has to pray that Hashem will give him what's good for him to come close to Hashem, which means, I cannot pray now to be rich. Hashem, give me, I need another million. Please, another million, I won't bother you anymore. I'm tired of asking people for help. Help me out. 1 million, I pay my mortgage, I pay this, I pay all the money I owe yeshivot for the kids. I have 2-3 years of rest. You'll see what a tzaddik I'm going to be. If you pray, you get your million in the end. And that will be the end of your life. After you made it, you begin slowly to become not religious. Going here, vacation, you're changing your car. Now you have all kinds of new toys. New computer, new telephone, new this, new that. It distracts you away from the Torah. What made you wicked? The million you ask for. Don't ask for it. Some people, it's the opposite. If they will make money, they'll come close to Hashem. Yes, depends, because they are grateful people. And as soon as they become rich, they want to show God, hey, you know, I appreciate you so much. How much you gave me? 1 million? Here is right away 30% I give tzedakah. Right away, the day he receives the money, he writes checks all day, from morning to night. I'll tell you, I know an American couple that used to live in Pennsylvania. Nice, very nice Jewish couple. And one of them had a company of fireworks. He used to do 4th of July shows, fireworks, real fireworks shows, big shows. Unfortunately, he bought something made in China, and it exploded in his face in the middle of a show. And he was in critical condition in hospital for 6 months. And then after, he was already 99% dead. Somehow, with a miracle, he survived, but he's very limited as far as physical. is, you know, his problems with his health over the years with medication, and he sued the Chinese government. Why the Chinese government? Why the Chinese government? Because they own the company. Come in his country, they have a piece in everything. So he sued them. 9 times he won $10 million. Not 6 times, I'm sorry. 6 times, every time they appeal, he won $10 million for the damage he had. Believe me, it's not enough for how much he suffered. Then he became religious. He started to listen to my lectures on the website, him and his wife. They sold their house in Pennsylvania and they moved to Israel. They bought a place in a religious neighborhood and became very religious. When I gave a lecture in Israel in the north, they even came to my lecture in Israel. And he's a great guy. He promotes my website to all his friends, to people, puts me on the radio, all kinds of things. He wants people to become more religious. Fantastic human being. And he sued the government many times. Then one time he calls me up, he says, and this is what he says. He says, when I get the money, right away I'm going to give a huge part of it to Kiruv. I will help you to make a lot of Balei Tshuva like nobody ever helped you. I'm going to give a huge amount. After all these times, he became very religious. The last appeal of the Chinese government, the same judge who ruled for his favor 6 times, I believe, and the last time reversed his decision and dismissed the case. Same judge. Who knows who they bribe? You know, the Chinese, you cannot win against them. It's 2 billion people against one. You know, it's very difficult. So I thought to myself, why Hashem did this to him? Why is it? And the answer is, all I can say it almost with no doubt. If he would take this $10 million, he would take away his Olam Haba. Why? Most of his life he lived like a goy. He wasn't an observant Jew. Finally, the last year or two, he became religious. Now you want a $10 million also? What? When are you going to pay for 50, 60 years of sins? When? So if you see a person that keeps Torah and mitzvot close to the end of his life, huge, win a big amount of money, that's a very serious reason to worry about him. That means Hashem took all his mitzvot, is not happy from them so much, and he pays him in this world, God forbid. Why? The last 3 verses in Parashat Vayetchanan, what does it say? I am the strict God who pay my lovers, who keep my mitzvot for thousands of generations, and pay my enemies, my haters, who do not listen to me, cash to their face to get rid of them. I will not delay their payment. I will pay them to their face to destroy them. What do you see here? If you got big money, big miracle for you, now you have to begin to cry, my friend. That means Hashem paid you in this life.
This is the Torah?
100% in Parashat Vayetchanan. Can you bring me Chumash? I'll show you. I'll read it to you word by word. Chumash. Any Chumash. No, Chamisha Chumshe Torah.
The
yeah, Chumash. No, not Zari. No, you don't have a full Chumash?
I'll check it out. Sorry. So how about?
Ain't la Chumash
for? She's looking for a Chumash.
How about if somebody is like young and they get money? If they're like 30, do you still have to worry?
No. No, no, it's a good question, and you know why not? Because that means his mission in life is to be a Baal Tzedakah, to help and to do mitzvot with the money. I was talking about a person that close to the end of his life became religious and all of a sudden became a millionaire. That's a reason to cry. Or when we, especially if we see wicked people that hardly make mitzvot, 10% mitzvot, 90% sins. These kind of people, what's happened to this kind of people? This kind of people, it's a clear indication that Hashem is paying them for the 10% good that they do in this life. Otherwise, why does He give them so much in this world? They have so many sins. Here, I'm going to read to you word by word. Here, we're almost done. Mamash, another few minutes. It says like this. And you should know You should know that your God is the God, the faithful God, who keeps his covenant and his kindness to his lovers who keep his mitzvot for 1,000 generations, and pay his enemies to their face to get rid of them, will not delay the payment to his haters, will pay them to their face, cash. Why? To get rid of them. Rashi writes clearly here, pay them the reward in this world, that he cannot let them enter the afterworld, the afterlife. So what we see here, the last thing you want is the last 10 years of your life to become rich, knowing it's for the 10-20% mitzvot that you did, and now you have to chas v'shalom go to Gehenom. Who wants this kind of reward? Why these people get temporary reward? Because their entire mentality, their entire way of thinking, it's all temporary. All they are searching in their life is for temporary pleasure. Women, this, vacation, money, food. All they want is like monkeys, like dogs, to enjoy the moment. They don't think for long run. I have to invest now that I'm going to receive the reward that God promised. Most of them don't even believe. Some of them make fun of it. The afterlife, you believe in it? Believe in Mashiach? Rabbi, you crazy? That's the way you say it. You talk, Hashem say, okay, you put tefillin in your bar mitzvah one time, I'll pay you for that. You made peace between two Jews, I'll pay you for that. You fast once a year on Yom Kippur, you donate some money to the shul, I take everything combined. And I see, based on what for you count as a great achievement, oh, you want to own a soccer team? I let your bid go through. Okay, now you're the owner. I'm so happy. I'm the owner of the, whatever their stupid name is. He comes, they make him sit in a VIP with his pipe, and everyone looks and clap for him. That's his reward. 10 years he enjoys until he gets cancer and he dies and finished. You understand what's going on here? Why is it? That's your dream. That's going to be your payment. That's why Rav Malka said, It's a famous thing, you know. It did not invent it. Don't ask, Hashem, I want Miriam. Please make her my wife, please. What do you mean? Maybe she's going to be poison for you. She could be a righteous woman. She's not the woman for you. You are a person full of energy and she's cold as ice. You and her will be like putting a lion and a tiger in the same room. You know what happened this week? The tiger killed the lion. You heard about it or no? My kids always ask me, Ava, who is stronger, the lion or the tiger? I never knew the answer. This is a gorilla, this is a gorilla. Lion and tigers. Today I got this week I got the answer. They went, they left them alone, the lion went into the room of the tiger, the tiger gave him something in his heart, ripped his heart, and killed him with his arm. So, at least it's 1-0 to the tigers. Until next week, we'll see if maybe there's an update. Anyway, so Hashem says like this. It says like this. All the desire that the prophets had and they spoke about for the days of Mashiach, that they will have rest from the empires of the Goyim who torture us so many years. And everybody will finally be able to sit and learn Torah without problems of Parnassah, problem of health, problem of Arabs around us, Roman, Babylonian, Persian, Philistines, without all this, without all day run to the army, bombs, rockets. Yes, you have money, you don't have money, you can afford whatever, none of these things. Finally, to be able to focus on the Torah. And they will gain wisdom that they should get this promised world to come. And at that time, the culture and the wisdom will rise to a record that it's never been in this world before. Even better than the time of the Tanaim. Wow, amazing. You know, to the highest level. Sheneemar ki mal'a aretz de'a et Hashem. The world will be full of wisdom to know God. Better than any generation. You understand what we're talking here about? Better than Matan Torah. Better than the prophets, better than anything. ולא ילמדו איש את אחיו ואיש את רעהו. כן? שנאמר, והסירות היא את לב האבן מבשרכם. השם will take the stone heart, it's an analogy, and replace it with a soft meat, heart, flesh. Right? And that king, the Mashiach, will be from the family of King David. He will be smarter than King Solomon. Nobody ever reached that level. This is the only time a person will be higher than King Solomon. And a bigger prophet, almost than Moshe Rabbeinu. In the same league. Lefichach, therefore, he will teach the nation and will show them the way to be close to Hashem. And all the Gentiles, all the righteous Gentiles, yeah, will come to hear him. That's all they will care about. שנאמר והיה באחרית הימים, in the end of days, the house of God will be in the top of the mountain. And all of them will come to gain and drink the wisdom of God. But days of Mashiach is this world, after all, and the days of the afterlife, the eternal life, it's a whole new league. It's a whole new thing. I think if you give me another 3-4 minutes, we'll be able to finish the series today. Better than to make another lecture about it. Let's finish it now. And we have only another six halachot. We can finish it now in a few minutes. A person should not say, I'm keeping the mitzvot of the Torah and the wisdom of the Torah to be blessed. That's the reason I do it. To be blessed. Or to inherit life of eternity. Or I'm going to save myself from making sins. That I will get saved from the curses in the Torah. Or that, God forbid, I will not lose my share to the world to come. This is not a high level of following Hashem. It's better than not doing it at all, for sure. But it's not the ultimate way. Because someone who does it is considered a worshiper of God out of fear. It's not a very high level. And it's not in the level of the prophets and the level of the sages. They didn't worship Hashem with fear. They did not serve Hashem with fear. This is good for ignorant people, for low level. And also for women who don't learn a lot of Torah. So they can reach a very high level. They don't learn Gemara, Talmud. They learn general things. And for little kids that still did not get any knowledge. To serve Hashem out of fear. Fear of the punishment.
So I can do that then?
Until one day they become wise enough. And they know knowledgeable, and now they begin to follow Hashem out of love. But a man that learns Torah most of his life, he should not be in the level of the children and the women. Why? Because the ultimate way is to follow Hashem out of love, out of appreciation, out of admiration, not because I'm afraid to go to hell. I know it's very hard. And I tell you something. Maybe it will comfort you. I make Balei Tshuva, Baruch Hashem, every day for 16 years. And I can count on one or two hands how many Jews I met that became religious out of love. On one or maybe two hands. All the other ones become religious because they're afraid to lose their parnasana, to get married, to lose their share to the world to come, to have cancer, and many other reasons. Or they feel embarrassed from Hashem. They're embarrassed. Embarrassment or ungratefulness. They don't feel comfortable. Their conscience bothers them. But out of real love, you know, love. Imagine a person that just met his wife and he's so excited. He cannot count the minute until the wedding is going to be and he's going to go back with her together finally. Just try to imagine this. If a person feels like this to Hashem. You understand? Yeah, no, if a person reached this level, that's a very high level. You know, it's not a joke. If a person would feel like this towards Hashem, I know a few people like this. Believe me, I know. But it's very, very rare.
But Rabbi, Talmud Torah goes into such an attribute of Hashem.
No.
When you read that book, Yeah. You cry. You just you love Hashem.
Right. 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 But it's only temporary. It lasts for a day or two. Right. We're talking people who there were way of life like this. I have a whole lecture about it. Search in a list. Someone who follow Hashem with love, learn Torah and keep mitzvot and follow the wisdom of the Torah, not because of his personal benefits, not because of fear, not because of reward, because that's the ultimate truth and the wish of God. This is the ultimate level. Why do you do it? That's what Hashem wants me to do, and I'm honored to do it. Will I get Olam Haba, not get, it's not my business right now. If Hashem would come and tell me, my friend, you will not come to the next world. That's it, I erased you. Will I still keep it with passion and admiration? That shows I'm a perfect human being. But if I stop right away, that means I'm egoistic. Everything I did was for myself, not for the truth. That's an indication. You know, sometimes you have your kids. You tell them, I want you to go clean the garage. What are you going to give me? So you know right away, he doesn't do it for the mitzvah. He does it for the candy or for the ice cream or for the $10 you give him. So sometimes you tell him, I'm not giving you anything. And he says, I'll do it anyway. Oh, that's a good boy. If you say, oh, you don't give me, I don't do. No, no. You know, like this, they go. Don't want to do. You're not a good boy. You do it for yourself, not for me. Cut the grass. Do I look like Jose to you? Who am I, Carlos? Call Carlos to do it. What do you want from me? Don't worry, I'll give you $20. 2 minutes later, grrr, the machine outside. Then you scream to him, I was just joking. Now you see if the machine will stop or not. If it stops, he does it for the money. If he continues to do it, oh, he does it because his father wants him to do it. That's a very high level. It's a great level. Not every scholar got to that level. Talmidei Chachamim, he knows a lot of Torah, but not everyone reached that level to do it because of the truth, not what I'm going to get out of it. And this is the level of Avraham Avinu, that Hashem called him my lover. Why? He followed Hashem out of love. And this is a great level. And this is what Moshe Rabbeinu said, ואהבת את Hashem Elokecha. You should love your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your money, no matter what your situation, what you get, what you don't get, first you have to love him. If a person does it and keep all the mitzvot from love, right, this is the ultimate level. How is it, Rambam says, that he feels that he's in love with Hashem just like he loves with a woman? The love that a person should feel to Hashem and to his Torah and mitzvot, just as much as a person is in love with his new wife that they just met and they just got married. The same excitement. Chole ahava. Love, it's a love addiction, sickness. That nothing in his life is manner except the love that he feels for this woman. And da'ato pnia ma'avat ota isha. His business didn't do so well, doesn't bother him. His mind is in the girl now. When she's going to call? When will I see her? He cares now. His Vini call. Senor, what happened? Business was very slow today, rain. Okay, amigo, eat something and go home. He doesn't care. Why? He's in love. Right? Anything that happened, he doesn't care. His car got scratched. What's his comfort? Right away, he's thinking about, Rachel. Very good. You know? Nothing bothers him. Why? You're talking to me about this. I have a gold mine. You're talking to me about $5. Right now, my mind is somewhere else. Right? Ushongeba tamid. Thinking about her nonstop. When he get up, when he go to sleep, when he wake up, when he eats. This is how the love to Hashem should be in the heart of every kosher Jew. This is an obligation. This is a mitzvah, not for individual special, for every Jew to get to this level. And this is what Shlomo HaMelech say, Ki cholat ahava ani. I'm sick out of love to you, Hashem. Cholat ahava.
V'chol shir ha-shirim, it's an analogy. The entire Song of Song is one big love story between the nation of Israel to Hashem, between Shlomo HaMelech to Hashem. Love, mamash like a love, like a man to a woman. That's how it's described. The sages said, I'm going to learn Torah because I want to be rich. I want to be called a rabbi. I want to get a huge reward to the next life. Why? Talmud lomar le'ava et Hashem. Don't do that for that. Do it for the love of Hashem. I love you, God. You are my father. You made me. You give me everything I have. I appreciate you so much. I can't live a second without thinking about you. Shiviti Hashem lenegdi tamid. Be'mitzvotav chafetz me'od ve'lo besachar mitzvotav. I'm interested to keep your mitzvot, not for the reward. The reward, fine. I'm honored to be able to keep your mitzvot, that you chose me from 7 billion goyim. I'm one of the only people who have the merit to do it for you. For that I'm honored. Not you give me olam haba, not olam haba, you make me a millionaire. No. And this is the way of the sages used to think. Don't be servants of the master for your salary, for your reward. Do it because he's your master. This is an example. Everyone who learns Torah to get a reward or to get safe from the tragedies or all kinds of sicknesses, areze osek shelo lishma. This is learning Torah not for the sake of heaven, for his own personal sake. V'chol haosek ba lo leira ve'lo lekabel sachar ela mipnei ahavat adon. And someone who learn Torah out of love to Hashem and appreciation to His wisdom, not out of fear or anything like that. That's a person who is considered in the highest level. Learn for the sake of heaven, for the sake of Hashem. And Chachamim say, if a person is hard for him to learn for the sake of heaven, he only learns out of fear from the punishment, because he knows if you don't learn, you get into trouble. Or anything else, or there's an epidemic in town, he wants to get saved, he knows the power of the Torah, or his son is sick, that's why he learned. This is not for the sake of heaven. It's better to start like this, and that would lead you eventually to learn for the sake of heaven. If you pray a lot to Hashem, this would lead you to the right way. You have to start somehow. Mitoch shelo lishma ba lishma. And that's how you teach the kids and the women and all the other ignorants. What is it? Take a candy. Take money to learn. Yeah, you offer them all kinds of things. Here, take this, I'll take you to a restaurant, I'll do this for you. They begin to learn, then they fall in love with that, then they can stop. With reward, without reward, they can live without it. Right? Davar ze yadua vebarur. It's well obvious and known that the love of God is in the heart of a person. Everything else in the world is like a peel of a garlic in his eyes. Nothing is, I care about nothing. Not a watch, not a tie, not a jacket, not a car. What kind of shoes I have. I have shoes. How beautiful my wife, not my kid. Pretty, not pretty, nothing. Only one thing fill up my heart and I'm in the moon. Nothing. Nothing I care. What kind of food, how delicious, sugar, not sugar. Nothing. Only one thing. Hashem, I'm in love with you. I'm crazy. I cannot a second without you. If a person reached this level, who needs Olam Haba? Here. In this life you have Olam Haba. I know one person, if you want to see how a person look when he gets to this level, come. I'll take you to Rabbi Rosenman in Monsi. I'll show you how he look, how he walks in the street. If you wouldn't know who he is, you think he's crazy. Like he took, I don't know, cocaine, heroin, I don't know how to call it. Like this. Why? Every second of his life is Torah in the upper level. It's not here. I ask him, Rabbi, I always see you like this. Tell me the truth. Did you ever get angry in your life? He said, why to get angry? Yeah, I don't know, somebody never got you angry. One time you scream, you got upset. He doesn't know where I fell. What are you bothering me now? He doesn't even know what does it mean to be angry. He's such in the moon.
Not very human.
Yeah. How did he reach this? He's so much in love with the Torah. Even when he walks in the street, he has a walkman.
He listens to words of Torah. He has a bag full of books. He walks from yeshiva to home, or from one place that he teaches to another. He has walkman. Why? The 20 minutes walk, how can I do it without Torah? That's what Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul told my cousin. He asked him, Rabbi, which mitzvah it's hard for you to keep? He told him, I don't understand how can it be that you sit in a bathroom for a few minutes without thinking about Torah. How can it be? It's not allowed to think about Torah in a bathroom. And so I just can't keep this mitzvah. I cannot keep this mitzvah. Sit 10 minutes in the bathroom and not think about Torah. I can't.
That's
I fail. I cannot keep it. We, maybe 10 minutes a day we think about Torah. Real Torah. And when is it? When we're in the bathroom. All of a sudden you become a genius. That's the Gemara. This, Abaye, Rava. In the bathroom, the Yetzer Hara is bringing the sugya that you learn in the yeshiva right away. And all of a sudden you wake up, what am I doing? I'm thinking Divrei Torah in the bathroom. Why? Over there, it's a sin. So over there, there's no Yetzer Hara not to learn. Put two people in the bathroom and give them Gemara. You see how they learn. The best learning they ever had in their life.
Put them in the mikvah.
Why? Because every second it's a sin. The Satan is happy, so he doesn't, no obstacle. Learn, good, learn more. No lunch, you're not hungry today. No lunch break, why? Good for me, it makes a lot of sin for me. He eats from our sin. He would leave everything in this world except the Torah. Nothing will matter. And we finish with one beautiful story. One person came, I think there was a Rebbe from Kotsk. He told him, Rebbe, everywhere I go I see this sign. Shiviti Hashem lenegdi tamid. Hashem is always in front of me, always in my heart, everywhere, everything. This is the ultimate life. Rabbi, how can it pass? How can it be? We put signs everywhere. How do you get to it? Like you asked before, how do you get to this level? So the rabbi told him, I'll demonstrate it to you. He called up two big gorillas over there. He said, take him, hold him tight, and bring him to the lake. And take him to the lake. He said, Rabbi, what are you doing? Let me go. He said, you wanted to know, no? We're going to show you what does it mean to think only about Hashem and nothing else. Rabbi, yeah, you're making me nervous. Shh. Put him. The rabbi said to the guys, when my finger goes down, you drown him. When it goes up, you pull him out. Ah! Shh. They put him in. He's trying. They push his head down. 10, 20 seconds. The rabbi said, up. Shh. They bring him out. Down. When he comes out, what does he do? Oh, right away into the water. He comes up, boom, kacha, like this, 10, 15 minutes. Then the rabbi says, okay, you can leave him alone. Ooh, it takes him a minute to breathe. Then he begins to scream. What kind of rabbi you are? You people are crazy. What is this torturing? Why do I ask questions? I say, I come to ask you, how do you think only about Hashem, and this is where you're drowning me? He said, no, you didn't get the point yet, huh? Tell me, when you were inside the water, did you think about something else besides air? Did you think about your businesses?
Air.
Did you think about your wife, how pretty she is today, this morning? No. Did you think about your son that became a doctor today? Who cares about it? Just give me air. Think about your new car that you bought? Did you care about the new mansion that you're building right now? All these things that before you came to me, non-stop you're thinking about all this nonsense. When you were inside, I can't breathe. What did you think about? The thing that is really important, not the rest. The rest, what good is to be dead and to have a mansion? What do I need right now? Air. This is what it means, Shiviti Hashem Negdi Tamid. When you understand that's the best thing for you, to be attached to God every second of your life, dwell about Him, dream about Him, talk about Him, think about Him, when you walk, when you do, every little thing you see a flower, psh, wow, what a creation. You see people, you see everything, it's all in your life. You walk, you think, will I do this? Hashem wants me to do. So all your life you're busy with Hashem. You are the happiest person in life. First of all, you get saved from losing a lot of money. Because most of the things we buy for ourselves, materialistic things, cost us fortune, and we work very hard for it, because we are losers in our level of faith and love to Hashem. Because when you love Hashem, you cannot love anything material. It's like sand, garbage, compared to a diamond. Person love diamond, he cannot love glass. Person love diamond, he cannot love mud. Mud is nothing to compare. You're comparing this to this. You understand what's going on here? Ah, when a person doesn't have time for Hashem, automatically he feels he looks for things to make him happy. 10 minutes, 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week. All these things, it's like drug, like Prozac. Keep me out of depression another day. No, tomorrow, another day. Why? I can't do it on my own. I need pills. I need, understand what's going on. What's the pill? Candy, Chinese food, this new tie, new car, every day a new watch. Why? My life is miserable, emptiness. If I don't have this, I'll kill myself. That's when you don't have Hashem. So you lose on both ways. You don't get the reward, and you don't have one piece of happiness, one moment of happiness. And Hashem that created the soul told us in the Torah, the food of the soul is my Torah. I created the soul, I know what gasoline to put in a car. You tried to teach me what gas to put in a car? I'm the manufacturer. What did I say? The Torah is the greatest thing for the soul. But the evil inclination will always show you sport is good, disco, dinners, beautiful wedding, $5,000 sushi, and then another $10,000 whiskey. That's life, Rabbi. What's the problem? Doing the same thing. No problem. But if you want to love Hashem, the way to love Hashem doesn't go with anything else. The more you love other things, it takes away from your love to Hashem. It's like you come to your wife and say, I love you, but I love other women. Your wife says, what's going on? You're supposed to love only me. The more you love other women, the more you don't love your wife. Very simple. Eventually, you don't have time for her. Huh? Because you love this woman and this one. You love 500 women. So, of course, what kind of marriage are you going to have? But if you only think about your wife and she's your whole life, no other woman interests you. For me, it's like another monkey who walks by. She can smile until tomorrow and go like this. I don't even open a window for her. You know, I look at her as a, I don't know, I don't want to say what. Walks in the street. What do I have with her? I have a fence. This is what I have. This is what belongs to me. And this is not in my territory. Ah, when I share my love to many things, it takes away from the real love of Hashem. Thank you very much. We finished the series. Thank you for keeping here. We'll see you again next week. Mizrachi.